Okay, we have a forum, and we have an empty chair there, and
there's a couple.
A couple of empty chairs. All right, so that's wonderful. We're so happy to have you all here today. I'm Vivian Wagle, and as I said, we're always delighted to have a good turnout for these events. And you're brave to come out in all this heat. So this is Robert Bailey. He's a very knowledgeable local historian, and he's going to educate us here today on Tomlinson Run State Park. And when his lecture is over, we would love to have people in the audience here share their memories and stories about the park also. And then we'll invite you to go and have some beverages and cookies. Okay, we've got a variety of, a huge variety in the kitchen. Okay, we always have an overload of food, so help yourselves. And Robert, I will leave it up to you.
Thank you. All right, everyone, thank you. Wow. A lot of folks. Especially in such a warm day. Today's lecture is really going to focus on the trees. Most of the time, we forage. Specifically, what's still there, what was there, and what you can still find today, and well, find it. I've lived in Hancock County my entire life. I run a small history group on Facebook that maybe a few of you might even be the reason why you're here tonight. And
Robert, we need for you to be a little louder.
All right, we can get a little closer to the mic. I had a feeling it might be tough back there. The fans aren't helping. That's okay. But I was saying that I have a history group on Facebook, the West Virginia Hancock History Project, and I've had it about 5 years, maybe 1,400 members now. Good group of people, only care about local history. But back to today, we're going to attempt to provide an accurate account of Tomlinson Run before anybody else lived here, when the first pioneers showed up. We're going to run down the 6 or 7 grist mills that are in the park, the Mineral Springs area. About half the presentation will rely on pictures and video, so you'll get to hear my voice, and me too, as that part goes on. We're really going to look at the early years. The water power of Tomlinson Run was really, you know, the veins, the arteries that gave power to all the agriculture and everybody who was here. The first mills were built in 1793. This is pretty soon. We didn't really have anybody living here prior to 1770 or so. European settlers, anyway. So let's get started into the early years. We are going to go down to the Pugh's Grist Mill and the Mineral Springs area. Most of this information, a good part of it, at least what spurred me, was a booklet written by Mr. Craig Heatens called Building Blocks. You can find a copy of it in the Chester Library. I'm sure other libraries may have one as well. And he really did the footwork, not only in the park walking around, but all the deeds, all the legal stuff, all the court battles, and really laid out who and what, when, and where. And, I came across the J.W. Mears map of 1871. I don't know if any of you folks are familiar with it. It shows who owns land around here, and every spring coal mine, just about every clay bed, just every little piece of nugget you can describe. And, well, I pick out a dot on the map, and I go find it. And then I put that on my modern maps, and I'll share both of those with you throughout this presentation. But we'll get started. For the first 7 minutes or so, it'll be all video, and then we'll start interrupting and filling in the blanks a little more as time goes on. If you've seen my videos on YouTube from the history group, it's about 40 or 50% of what will be presented today, and then it'll be elaborated, hopefully, some more. So let's go ahead and get started.
All right, so today we find ourselves at Tomlinson Run State Park, Hancock County, West Virginia, just outside of the town of New Manchester. And today we're going to explore the Mineral Springs Picnic Area. We're going to be focused on the southern portion of the park, closest to Route 8, near where the pool is. Parking for the Mineral Springs area can either be near the pool and walk down, or there's a spot just down the road along Route 8 from the park entrance. Taking a look here at the J.W. Beers 1871 map of the northern panhandle of West Virginia, just north of New Manchester along Route 8, the mills are marked here in green. The Silverthorn Dam and Sawmill shown here, and just upstream across the bridge on Route 8 was Hugh Pugh's Grist Mill. Also clearly marked on the map is the word Sulphur Spa, highlighted in red. Notice the area where the pool sits today was known as Rocky Point at that time. All right, let's go ahead and head on in. As you head into Mineral Springs, one of the first things you'll notice is there's an old road that kind of cuts off here to the right. There's another one right down there. We'll head to there next. All right, we've made it a little further down the road here. And again, off to the right, you can see another road taking off. This time we're gonna follow it. The other one was just right there. So they go to the same place. This was the location of the Sanatorium Resort, Fairview Resort, and Mineral Water Company. This was New Manchester's own spa resort. Overlooking Mineral Springs, right down there.
Building in the foreground is the back of the Mineral Springs Spring House. Up to the left on the hill, you can see the original sanatorium home that burnt down in the 1930s.
Just above the resort, you can find their own well. Stone line. Last time I was here, it was full near to the top with debris. Now it seems to be filled much less. All right, here's a parting shot of what was the sanatorium building site. And now we'll head down to the Mineral Springs area, the Silverthorn Dam, and look at the spring itself. And here's our first look at the Mineral Springs Resort area. Dam, mill, resort up on the hill, road, spring, chicken coops. Fairview Summer Resort and Mineral Water Company, incorporated July 1896. On March 12, 1861, Joseph Silverthorn entered into an indenture with Messrs. Levi Caldwell, S.W. Wilson, W.M. Flanagan, Eli Flanagan, Silas Norman, James Cummins, and W.M. Michener. Joseph leased his land 20 years for oil privileges. He reserved sufficient land for his log and lumber yard to run his sawmill and to use his two lots and garden. In return, Joseph was to receive every 10th barrel of oil,
Water was found instead. For about 30 years, the sulfur water flowed out over the ground. On July 10, 1896, A.B. Mercer and W.G. Stone incorporated and started what is now known as Mineral Springs. Dr. Stone operated a sanatorium near this site to treat stomach and kidney diseases. The best-known owners of this 10-acre local attraction were Chester B. and Dorothy C. Pease. They managed a beer garden, dance hall, roller rink, picnic grounds, and cottages from October 1926 until November 1954.
Pewtown Mineral Spring. This well was drilled for oil in 1861 by a company composed of residents of this community. It is 630 feet deep. After striking this enormous flow of water, it was abandoned and permitted to flow out over the grounds. The offensive odor and chemical deposits showing in the water led people to believe it was poisonous or unfit for use. After 30 years, or about 1891, it was analyzed and found to contain very valuable medicinal qualities. About this time, a doctor named Stone started a sanatorium in the old homestead where it can be seen overlooking the grounds. After some very remarkable cures of stomach and kidney diseases, the doctor had to discontinue for lack of funds. In those days, there were no paved roads nor automobiles, making it comparatively easy to reach the place. You cannot drink enough of this water to injure yourself, but you can drink too little to obtain any benefit. There's a full chemical analysis of everything in the water. This water is claimed to be the best balanced mineral water for general health known in the USA. Pewtown, WVA. Here's the label that was on the bottles of water. Pewtown Mineral Water, the health water. Analysis by Pittsburgh Testing Laboratory. Full listing of all the chemical composition there. Pewtown Mineral Spring. This water is highly recommended by the leading authorities of the medical profession of Cleveland in diseases due to faulty elimination. My analysis of this water proves that it is a valuable one with a mild apparent action, recommended for stomach and kidney troubles, rheumatism, etc. Did you notice that phone number? Chester, 7105, ring 6. Someone's going to have to explain to me how phone numbers like that work. This is a photo of the inside of the spring house at Mineral Springs. Notice the communal cup for everyone's benefit. Below the cliffs was the site of the Mineral Spring Well, which the park pulled up in early 1988. It's easy to see from this view of the spring house that Mineral Springs was an awfully pleasant place to hang out. You can also see that the spring was directed outside, so it could be enjoyed there as well. In the photo on the left, left to right, we have Dora Petrie, Ruth Gorsuch, Frida Gorsuch, Billy Gorsuch, Blanche Gorsuch, Dorothy Pease, Winnie Pease, Chester Pease, and Chico the dog. Chester Pease is holding one of the glass bottles of mineral spring water. Here we have Armour Garcia, Dorothy Pease, Doria Petrie, Charles Petrie, and an unidentified female. Best known owners of this 10-acre local attraction were Chester B. and Dorsey C. Pease. They managed a beer garden, dance hall, roller rink, picnic grounds, and cottages from 1926 until 1954. Through the Pease era, they ran the speakeasy during the Prohibition and sold the mineral water. Later, the Pease family added cottages, a picnic area, a dance and roller rink, and the beer garden, which is a really nice name for a bar. The Fullers then took over and carried on for another 8 years before the state of West Virginia purchased the site in 1962. Upon purchase, the state of West Virginia razed the entire site, ending this chapter in history.
I do know that up here on top of these rocks, right behind the mineral spring, there are some bricks laying there. I understand there were chicken coops kept there. They could be reached from the third story of the house that was built down here. Look at the mineral spring today. It is flowing. Water is going out into the nearby creek. half you climb up here, find this large leveled out section, and blocks at the front edge of them here, and some more all the way across. So a lot of space for chickens. Nice view for the chickens. There's the dam there, and the springs right there below it.
The story starts with the Silverthorne Dam in 1861, where Joseph Silverthorne built the dam to power his mill. Several layers of the stones have been removed to lower the water level above the dam. Does seem like it would have been a great place to swim, though. Here's a view of the Mineral Springs area on the J.W. Beers map of 1871, showing the Silverthorne Mill and also Hugh Pugh's grist mill, which was located just upstream of the bridge on Route 8. The site transpired from a sawmill owned by Joseph Silverthorne, a failed oil venture, a summer resort, a sanatorium, water company, a speakeasy during the Prohibition, to an all-day family recreation area.
Well, that sure is interesting. I wonder if those rocks fell all at the same time, or if they fell on top of each other and just stacked. Huh. On our way back out.
The Mineral Springs area. Unfortunately, the Pugh grist mill is on private property, so I've never really got to explore it, and there really aren't any photographs of it that I'm aware of, but it's definitely there. I want to take a minute and mention Craig Heatens again. Craig's the one who wrote Building Blocks, which was really my inspiration in getting started in this about 15 years ago, and Bob Marshall.
Robert?
Yes. I'm sorry. Talking about Mr. Craig Heaten and his book Building Blocks, and Bob Marshall, many folks call him Sky Raider. He's a personal, he's an historian also, and he's Chester and Dorothy Pease are his grandparents. So he knows a lot more about the park than many folks do. Now we're going to move into Murray's Mill. Murray's Mill is kind of lost. Nobody knows exactly where it was. The only description on the deeds is that it was where the north and south forks of Tomlinson Run came together, which most folks thought was where the dam is, and it was long gone. I don't think it is. I think I found it, and I'll show you that now. This is the bridge just below the dam on Tomlinson Run. Looking downstream. And about that area there, you can find remnants of a dam. Let me try to get it going here. Alright. If you move down on the right side of the stream, you'll come across this stack of boulders. Well, work stones. And just across from it, you find this stone wall. Stepping back, you can see it's not that far down from the bridge. And just to the left of that area is a raceway. A raceway is typically where the water off of a dam is directed to get to the mill. And it's pretty obvious in the terrain. Going a little bit deeper, and we're going to switch gears here to maps. Get my mouse to cooperate with me. Here we go. These are, on the right, is the J.W. Beers map of 1871. This map, I've tried to seek out everything on it that I could find and translate it to the map you see on the left. If we zoom in here to the Tomlinson Run area outside of New Manchester, this is where the north and south forks of Tomlinson Run come together. And most people thought that, again, the mill was a lot closer to where the dam is. Just downstream, here to the left, you can see the words barely. It says G-M-I-L-L. And you might argue with me that that's not what that says, and I wouldn't blame you. But if you go back up to where the other two mills are, you can clearly see how they're written. How the G's written, how the M has these serifs on it, and this little tail on the L of mill seems to repeat itself on the other mills. So I'm pretty convinced that that also says G Mill. Neatly enough, right next to it is William C. Murray's house. The final piece of that equation, for me anyway, in here to that section on this map, this would be that area of Tomlinson Run, and trying to show you the dam. There's a dot on the map approximately here, and in that exact spot, there is a depression where there was surely a foundation for something. And then the raceway that goes down along. At the end of that raceway, there's a capped well. And the reason that's important is it's known that Murray's mill was eventually converted over to gas, and he also built a sawmill and several homes nearby that also ran on gas. So between finding the raceway, the dam, and the gas well, I'm somewhat convinced that this is the location of Murray's mill. Nobody else agrees with me yet at this point. So we'll say that. But I'm meeting with Bob Marshall hopefully in the coming weeks, and we're going to attempt to, I'm going to attempt to convince him and see what his thoughts on it are. So going back into the video, I think I have another picture of the raceway, and that's about the extent of it. Breaks that are in the creek in that area right next to the dam debris. And then, yeah, it's tough to see here, but this is a depression that goes down, makes a right turn, kind of following the creek. And there's no real clear sign anywhere along it where there might have been a mill. But I'm still pretty convinced that that's where it is. We'll find out. But that would be the third mill on Tomlinson Run so far. So now we'll talk about the dynamite shacks for a minute. Anybody been to the dynamite shacks? Anybody know what they are, other than that they store dynamite, or how it went down? They're interesting little structures for sure, and if you didn't know they were there, when you come across them, well, get your curiosity going, that's for sure. I'll show you a couple pictures of those real quick. Here's all three of them. The one on the right here is the smallest of the three, and you see it's much further away from the other two. These things were built out of brick. They're two layers thick, 7/8 inch boilerplate doors, and they originally had three layers of 3/8 inch plywood on the doors. On the inside of them, they're all well ventilated with wooden slats. And vent holes top and bottom, pretty much all the way around. And they do have wooden roofs, so that if there ever was an explosion, you would literally blow the roof off the place. It's like another picture of the doors there. You can see the double layer of the brick. The brick was to keep them cool as much as possible, ventilation as much as possible. And supposedly the two layers of brick and the door boilerplate with the wood backing would stop a bullet from a Springfield rifle. And that's, I guess, what they were attempting to accomplish. The smaller one held caps and fuses, and that's why it's so far away from the other two. The smaller, shorter building here on the side of the hill was probably used as a utility shed. And the largest one, based on its size, the information I'm reading tells me that it would probably have held somewhere between 15 and 20,000 pounds of explosives. which is why it was so important to keep it away from the caps and fuses. The other part of that that I'll show real quick is that they took the local topography into mind when they built these things. If you look at where they are, halfway down a hill, surrounded by nearly 220 degrees of hillside, you really mitigated the possible damage that could occur if something did go wrong. So yeah, those are the dynamite checks. They're along the New Manchester Turnpike, which we'll talk more about as we move forward. It gets another shot, and that's the largest of the three buildings where the most likely the explosives were held. Most folks think that was utility shit. All right, the mystery mill. There is a mill on Tomlinson Run that nobody knows anything about, other than it's there. It is straight down from the group camp, short walk on the beach trail, and you'll come to this area here. The blue line represents the raceway and the mill there, and there's a strange pathway going to it, and stairs that go down to the mill, like stone stairs in the hillside. This mill does not appear on the 1871 map. So it either had to have not been being used anymore, or it wasn't there yet. One of the two. One possibility that I think is, and this is a stretch maybe, but supposedly Murray had built his grist mill and a separate sawmill on his property. Maybe the sawmill wasn't as close as everybody thinks it is, and maybe this was it. But no, I don't know. I can't find an answer to that yet. And searching deeds is not my best thing, I'll be honest. So let me show you some video of the mystery mill so you can see what is there. Foundation's about 3.5 to 4 or 5 feet tall all the way around. That would be the raceway here where the water would come through. It goes under a bridge and then back out to the creek like all the rest of them do. This looks to be an entrance into the basement of it, so it's decent size. But no explanation as to who owned it or even what it did, other than it was most certainly a mill. That's the road above it that comes in. It's the top of the stairs. It kind of looks like a raceway itself. But that would kind of represent where the water would come through over the bridge, past the mill. This is from the mill looking down toward back toward the creek. Another overview of it. I wish I could share more information. There just really isn't any, other than it's there. All right, we're going to now move into my favorite part of the park. The wilderness area, if you don't count the New Manchester Turnpike, it doesn't have any roads. You have to hike to everything in it. And it's not that far. It's about 3 miles through each way. But this is going to jump into some video about one of the most unique mills in the park, if not the state of West Virginia, maybe even the country. It's really got a unique feature that no other mill has, and I'll try to present that to you as best I can. Let's go ahead and get started.
Today we're going to explore the Upper and Lower Laurel Trails and the White Oak Trail. Many parts of both of those were originally the New Manchester Turnpike, believe it or not. We're going to start our journey near the Old Mill Scout Camp along Washington School Road, which runs right through the edge of the park. Soon come to the intersection of the Laurel Trail and, well, the old New Manchester Turnpike. There's the rock there. Laurel Trail comes in here. Here's the roadbed. Down the hill goes to the Fairview Woolen Mill.
The Fairview Woolen Mill operated from just before 1830 to sometime after 1880. The mill had several owners throughout its lifetime. The mill was also known by many other names. What made the Fairview Woolen Mill most unique is that the water was fed through a 400-foot tunnel through the hill, giving a water drop of 10 to 12 feet to turn that machinery that must have been in that rather large mill. You see, the blue highlights the water coming down out of the hillside past the orange water wheel under the road represented in green and then back out into the creek.
All right, so yeah, they use a tunnel. Like, that's amazing. If you're standing on Washington School Road at the bridge by the old Mill Scout Camp, and I imagine most of us have been there, and you're looking upstream, something in my eye, I apologize, you'll see this a depression up there. And I'm just using it as a landmark. If this does show up on the 1871 map, but I can't read the name, so I can't tell you what it was for sure. Just above that, though, there are four depressions in the hillside. And I happened to be lucky enough to catch it this day when the snow hadn't melted in just those depressions. If you're walking upstream along the creek, a quick way to find the first one is this tree, because it's hollow, and it just really stands out. You really can't miss it. Just up from those four depressions, I'll point out that you're standing in the raceway of the mill here, where the water would have been fed to these tunnels. Just above that, so let's stop this again. We're probably headed to this spot up here where my mouse is pointing, and this is the raceway right through here that runs past those tunnels. So just above it's a large boulder. It's big, can't miss it, trees are stuck on it. That line across there represents where the dam was. You can see large stones across the creek. Cut stones, keystones, so to speak, that the dam would have blocked into. The large boulder is also cut out for blocks to be cut into it, and I tried to represent that there best as my finger painting would allow. If you catch the water low enough, you can see the foundation of the dam, and it does go all the way across the creek and lines up perfectly with both keystones. So, unquestionably, the dam was way upstream of this mill, and the only logical way to get it there would be through a tunnel. It also gave a huge water drop. The more water drops, the more power it has. So, in a lot of ways, it was really smart. So here we are back at the old Mill Scout Camp. The building would have actually been taller than that, but that's a fair representation of its location. The bridge over here to the right. This fire pit, by the way, I have slept on at least three of these stones all night long throughout my years in Scouts. It makes for rough mornings. Here's another representation of it, trying to show the bridge and the road. The water would have come down out of the hillside and turned this water wheel, go, and then it shot out underneath the road through a tunnel and then back into the creek. So, quite an elaborate setup for a mill of its time. Again, trying to show you how it flowed down out of the creek if you walked there yourself. This is what the out tunnel looked like in 1985. When I first saw it in the early 90s, you could still find it, but it was half that height. Now it's really not there at all. I mean, you can find the wood going across it, basically. There's a cutout, one of the large stones there, that some people seem to believe had something to do with the water wheel itself. Maybe it did, maybe it didn't, but there's its size, and it's still there. So that stone's gone untouched. And then I think I have shown you the output of the tunnel here, which larger and a little scarier than you might imagine. But then that just drops right back out to the creek. So they rerouted that creek through the hillside, 400 feet, to power that mill. And, well, it's a pretty big mill. I don't know if it actually had a basement or not, but certainly half the water wheel was underground. So what I would love to see happen And I'm sure it won't happen anytime soon. But I think we have a good opportunity here at Tomlinson Run to, we have three mill sites at Murray's Mill, the Mystery Mill, and the Woolwood Mill. They have no signage. There's nothing there to represent that anybody knows that they're there. Arguably the reason why the place became a park. We've never communicated it. So I would love to see signage at these mill sites, identifying what's there and what's going on. And if I really, really could dream big, I'd rebuild Murray's Mill. It's small. It was the smallest of the mills. It was the earliest one, built in 1793. It was really just a shed with a water wheel. That wouldn't be impossible to make happen. Being that that's in such a primary part of the park and they're so close together, it wouldn't be one of the grandest mills around, but I think it could be a great place to show how primitive it can be done. But that's a story for another day. So let's jump back in. We're going to head down the New Manchester Turnpike. We're going to stop at the George Baxter residence along the way, and well, a bunch more places.
And a little further down, you'll see the remnants of what most folks believe was a spring house.
Look, I couldn't stop myself there. This is George Baxter's homestead. We've just come back up from the bridge here, hit the old Mill Scout camp, come up the hill, and just as soon as the hill levels out, you start seeing remnants of George Baxter's home. And you can see that this dot on the map is significantly larger than most other homesteads. So he must have had quite the spread. And when you get up to this location, you can start to see a fieldstone wall, a spring house. There's a large hole that's stone-lined that I really don't know what it was for, with some other items next to it. If you follow it down, it comes to like an 8x8, 8x10 stone foundation with a hand-dug well, just like the stone-lined one that we looked at earlier. And then just over from there, you can find his homestead location. And this long green line is a large berm of dirt that goes perfectly straight. I don't know if it was because they leveled a road to his house, or maybe he had water issues. I don't know, but it's there. But anyway, that's where we are right now. And his name comes up a lot, and there's just pay attention that George Baxter had a lot of property.
This folks believe was a spring house. Right-hand side, up the hill a little ways. Foundation stones, again, that's what everyone thought was a spring house. Just down the way, across the New Manchester Turnpike, back across the trail, you'll see a pretty big hole. Clearly a foundation for something. Back on the trail, the Upper Laurel Trail, the old New Manchester Turnpike. Alright, we're coming up on the split where the Upper and Lower Laurel Trails meet together with the White Oak Trail. Now let's head out to White Oak Run, head down the White Oak Trail. That'll take us to, well, we'll follow the New Manchester Turnpike. There's many relics of it along the way. Elpo Rock, lovely double waterfall, the H.H. Williams Homestead, an oil rig, and Thomas Hudson's Sawmill are all down that way. Let's go. First V in the road. It goes up the hill there, and one goes there, lower on the hill. There were many variations of the turnpike over the years, and the one coming down the hill is
Wellsville Road that eventually connected here. Also, when you get here, you'll begin to see some of the first man-made structures along the New Manchester Turnpike. There are many large stone walls. It's an idea to get a scope of some of these walls. This one doesn't end till down there.
Jump in here real quick and look at the New Manchester Turnpike on the map for a second. First off, where are we? We are here. This green lines along the road here are everywhere there's a road, where there's basically one of those large walls holding up the road. And man, some of them are really long and 8, 10 plus feet tall. They put a lot of effort into it, no doubt. Zooming out far, the New Manchester Turnpike went from New Manchester to Congo. At that time was Hamilton. Going the other way, it followed Florence Road across Tope Hill, well, I should say across Harden's Run, then out Tope Hill to the PA line. This was a toll road for only about 3 years. In fact, where Nestle Road would meet White Oak Run is where one of the toll booths were. It's marked on the maps. None of the other ones are, for whatever reason. But it went right through the park. And A great many of the trails in the park are roads. The ones up around the ponds, the Poe Trail, Bigfoot Trail, and the Maple Trail, and the Fern Trail are all trails. The rest of them are all roads, in one way or another. And it really was, it's a shame we lost them. They would have been comfortable. They would have been handy roads. But it's a great thing we got the park. But yeah, that it only remained a toll road for about 3 years, and it then got turned into a public highway. They actually raise the money by having residents buy stock. Don't know how that worked out.
February 18th, 1828. An act establishing a turnpike passed the General Assembly. A survey in accordance with the act was made, starting from Hamilton's Ferry, present-day Congo, opposite of Wellsville, by New Manchester, at that time in Brook County, to the Pennsylvania state line. The road only continued as a turnpike for nearly 3 years, after which time it was turned into a public highway. Other than the sections of the road that pass through the park, the rest of the turnpike remains used to this day.
Here's one of the walls with grain in action.
A list of some of the earliest settlers of Tomlinson Run. Samuel Baxter settled in what is now Grand District in 1798. John Nestle Road settled about 1795. Jacob Nestle settled near the mouth of Tomlinson Run in 1785. In 1800, or near that time, George Baxter, old Mr. Corey, and George Wilhelm migrated to the county. William Murray settled here in 1818. Robert Glass in 1813, he settled 1 mile east of Fairview. Hugh Pugh settled on the 400-acre tract where Fairview was situated in 1800. James Allison settled on the farm owned by Jonathan Allison, the grandson of James, on the road leading from Fairview to East Liverpool in 1800. John Johnson settled on the north branch of Tomlinson Run in 1802. Samuel Carruthers settled on the headwaters of Tomlinson Run in 1800 and erected one of the first still houses in what is now Hancock County. David Pugh also had a small still house on the same run from about 1804 to 1812. John Bailey settled on the north branch of Tomlinson Run in 1800, and Mr. Pittenger located here in 1798, settling on the old road from Fairview to East Liverpool.
We do get back on top. Boy, are there some impressive rocks here.
I think that one's looking at.
Well, now we've come to the mouth of White Oak Run into Tomlinson Run. It's somewhere right near here was a crossing of a road on Tomlinson Run. And I think it was right over there. We're going to go ahead and head upstream of White Oak Run. Follow the White Oak Trail. Approaching the end of the White Oak Trail at the old bridge abutment that crossed White Oak on the New Manchester Turnpike, well, at least one iteration of it.
All right, the reason I kind of make fun of the end of the White Oak Trail is I can't understand, and I don't mean to step on anybody's toes, and maybe it's just an error in the map, but we were at the confluence of White Oak and Tomlinson Run, and we walked up White Oak, and we're here where the bridge is. That entire area is plastered with no trespassing signs. I don't know why. It encourages folks not to explore that part of the park. Not that there's a lot there, but there's a really nice double waterfall up there. So yeah, that's one of the things I've always been curious about as to, you know, which is right. So I stay out of it, but
these trees are all blaze and blue.
We will, however, go back down, find ourselves a place to cross White Oak without getting our feet too wet, and we'll try to head up to Elpo Rock. Right here near the bridge abutment, there are quite a few carvings in the tree. Why someone would put this one here with these marks, I'm really not sure. Interesting.
So yeah, I don't know if that's anything of significance or not. It's in a significant place where the bridge crosses White Oak. It doesn't look like that's something you would do for graffiti, I don't think. Like, I understand, you know, initials and pictures. That almost looks like it's measuring something or possibly showing you how to get somewhere or road directions or, I don't know. I just found it interesting that kind of stood out to me as, why would you just draw lines if you were going to put graffiti like that on a tree? I'm not sure I understand. But anyway, it's a neat little thing that you can find there. It's actually this tree right over here.
Run.
And there's the New Manchester Turnpike on the way to Elpo.
All right, we're not going to go up to Elpo directly. We're going to turn around and walk up White Oak a little further.
Come down from Baxter Sugar Camp. Crosses White Oak right there.
This is Baxter's Sugar Camp. Does anybody know what a sugar camp is? They show up on maps all the time. You'll see Sugar Run, Sugar Grove, Sugar Valley. Associated would be Maple Grove, Maple Valley. It's where people made syrup, maple syrup typically. Sap runs in February, a lot of it. And you have to boil it down like 50 to 1. So if you imagine a 55-gallon drum of tree sap that you're going to boil down to a gallon of maple syrup, you really don't want to transport the 55-gallon drum. So they would build camps. They would stay on site. They would keep a fire going for 6 weeks straight and just boil down sap endlessly. And therefore, you could easily haul out the, you know, condensed maple syrup. But that part of the park, that little end piece that looks like, you know, like a boot almost, it includes these little things, and I don't think much of it was accidental. I wish I could speak to the person who you know, got to make those choices.
And just down from there, the water has carved two little chutes out of this large rock. climbing the hill to Elpo Rock. Almost there. Not long before you make it to Elpo, come across this old oil rig. Always amazes me. It always seems to have new lines and fittings. And across the road from that pump, big old tank. Make our way around the front. See if the daffodils are up. Ha ha, they are. Every year, year after year, you can find these daffodils. Right across from Elpo Rock. Good look at Elpo Rock. Liverpool Post Office drop-off point for folks that live along the New Manchester Turnpike. Everybody, pick up, drop off their mail, and here. What's really interesting is the rock itself has some pretty neat carvings in it. Flag on a building, 1879, DC, star with a circle, there's Elpo right there, and well, maybe something after it. So that's Elpo Rock. East Liverpool Post Office. Drop off and pick up point for the New Manchester Turnpike. There, I'm taking a moment. I highlighted the historical carvings. Almira and Julia. Bow and arrow. To the left. Sunday, August 22nd, 1878. E. Williams. W. Gardner. So as a reminder, the road goes right past Elpo Rock. Right up here to our left is an intersection, and then the H. Williams Homestead. We'll visit there next.
So yeah, East Liverpool Post Office. Who would have thought about leaving their mail there? yeah, I was surprised when I learned it existed, and I had to go find it. And it certainly is there. looking closely at that area, you can see that quite a few things show up over here. Is all that oil rig and tanks and such. Elpo Rock, some old oil stuff, and I found there's a pipeline that runs by here, so I followed it one day. It took me up to a foundation, which led me to another foundation, which led me to an open well and a homestead foundation. And then the foundation stones I'm about to show you now. When I made the video, I hadn't found the other things yet. So that was really all I had available at the time. But it was enough to make me realize that the pipeline is what gave it away. It has to go somewhere. So we'll look at that real quick.
All right, there's Elpo down there. New Manchester Turnpike Road comes up here, comes to here, and then splits. One goes down the hill toward Tomlinson Run Creek, and then one goes out, hooking up eventually with Welton Road that comes up from Nestle Chapel. Right here at the corner of this intersection is where you can find the H.H. Williams Homestead. There's not a whole lot left, but as you walk into the woods here at this intersection, you will begin to see some foundation stones. Very evenly spaced out along the landscape. I believe there's four of them here. And some other larger stones. Here you can see the four stones in a row. All right, we're gonna head to the trail down the hill back toward Tomlinson Run Creek. Following along this section of the road, back down and get you along the creek. If you would to follow it all the way down, this would bring you out at the backwater near Cow's Farm. Off in the background there is the Thomas Hudson Sawmill. We're heading there next. Though it's tough to see, Thomas Hudson Sawmill sat right there, and the stones all around its base. The unique thing about this particular sawmill is it used a reciprocating blade, like a jigsaw would. Very unique for its time. Most sawmills would have used a rotating blade. Just down from here, there was another building. Right there, there's some bricks and so forth. If you walk down and look around, you'll find its foundation. It's listed as one of Thomas Hudson's properties. It must have went along with the mill. And his house is way up on the hill down there, about a mile away, was the old Thomas Hudson homestead.
Yeah, so this would have been his homestead here. This purple line represents old Route 2, and it's actually this little piece of it would now be part of Ferndale Road, that hard turn you make right after you leave the backwaters. The road that goes up the hill that's on private property, that, you know, an old dirt road, that would take you right up to his homestead, which was a house that probably rivaled this one in its time. It's pretty elaborate. It's in unrepairable disarray at this point, though.
For now, we'll head back up. Back on the trail, White Oak Trail, headed up Tomlinson Run. However, if you find another one of those, like on Elpo Rock, that's interesting. It points toward Elpo Rock from here. All right, find ourselves back to the junction of the White Oak Trail that I'm coming off of. The Upper Laurel Trail. So for now, let's head down the Lower Laurel Trail toward the bridge abutment few old homes that we can't see from this side of the creek, and Hartford's grist mill. Alright, the old bridge abutment is right there. It's tough to follow, but right there is the old roadbed going up the hill. On your way back from the bridge, there's the Lower Laurel Trail, the road. There's another road just off here, not far up from the creek. This one goes down to Hartford's Grist Mill. We're going to head down there now.
This is a hand-drawn survey by James G. Marshall in 1882.
All right, we'll stop there and jump into the map. Looking at a survey here, here's the bridge abutment that we're standing near. The line just downstream of it represents the dam, and then the raceway that ran to the mill to feed it with water. Everything but the dam still there. Jump back up to the right spot here. Here we go. This is kind of what that area looks like today. The main road would be this green line here that comes up to the bridge. Now, there's several offshoots that go to little properties, a little mine, and to Hartford's Grist Mill, and there's a road that parallels the raceway right up to about where the dam was. I'm assuming from the dam to the raceway, there must have been a wooden structure to deliver the water across that distance. Otherwise, I don't know how it could have worked. Yes, that's where we're at the moment. I just thought I'd try to locate you.
There's the road coming into Hartford's Mill.
Yeah, I didn't bother reading this because, well, this one's by the pool entrance. The millstones that are there are from Hartford's Grist Mill. Everybody agrees that that location is Hartford's Grist Mill, and it is in Tomlinson Run Park. And that's important later, that's why I wanted to bring it up. Hartford's Grist Mill, stop this again before it goes away. Notice on the far right here there's a conveyor belt that goes across the creek up to a coal mine, which is how they eventually powered the mill when they converted it to steam. Most of the mills converted to steam before it was over with.
Originally powered by water wheel, but then was later converted to steam boiler, powered by coal. All right, here we are, Hartford's Mill. This is what remains today. Left of the mill site here, foundation going around, the back wall, you'll see the creek is very scenic in this area, strewn with large boulders, and just a little further upstream here, we'll find the remnants of the old bridge abutment. My understanding is this was a covered bridge, but I've never seen a photograph of it in order to confirm that. You can see the bridge abutment up there now. Here is where the bridge once was. However, no longer is. And this particular bridge, 20 feet up. Look closely, you can see the stones of the abutment over there. It's kind of squared off. And then the road heads up. Looking at the maps for this area, there are a couple other homes that were found on the other side of this bridge. If you follow this road up, it will connect you to 6 Road, I believe. Yes, 6 Road, coming up from the backwaters.
This is a hand-drawn survey by James G. Marshall in 1882. It is believed that at least one of the two houses shown on the drawn survey by Mr. Marshall is the home of John Knoll and birthplace of Reverend James M. Knoll. John Knoll was a native of Washington County, Pennsylvania, and was born in June of 1796. Migrated to Hancock County and settled in Fairview, where John worked as a tanner for 14 years. In 1836, John started working at Murray's Mill, learning the milling trade until 1839. He then purchased Coulter's Mill.
Alright, we're going to jump into that real quick. No one's really known where the birthplace of and the homestead of James M. Knoll was. I think I found it. Not sure. But based off of descriptions out of his autobiography, written in 1931, reading this paragraph, says, "My father's mill and sawmill," which we know was Hartford's mill, "were built in a little valley absolutely surrounded by hills. The valley was about 500 yards wide." This valley is exactly 500 yards wide. "Above the valley, about some about 300 or 400 feet, was the point of a hill overlooking the most wild and picturesque country one could wish to see. West Virginia is especially famous for its beauty of scenery, wild and rugged and mountainous. This spot was like much of the rest. There on that point of a hill was built a frame house of 4 rooms. That house is standing yet. There in November of 1840, I began my howling life." Well, that's the only point that overlooks the mill. 300 or 400 feet above it. Valley's 500 yards wide. So I climbed up there, and sure enough, there's a foundation for a home there. There's about a 6-foot long stone horse trough that was kind of nice, if you ask me. And it's just outside of the Mark Park boundaries. But yeah, I'm pretty sure that that's where it is. Another one of those things I'm trying to work with some other folks and confirm.
Go ahead and head up the Laurel Trail, the lower Laurel Trail, which follows the creek. Let's go. Here's another look at the bridge upstream. Beauty around here is well worth the trip.
About the year 1795, a man named John Nesselrode started a small black powder factory on a farm later owned by George Baxter. He built a log cabin and produced black powder for nearly 6 years. At that early date, powder and lead were very scarce. Being in great demand by the settlers, they brought a nice price. Game abounded in the forest in large quantities, and in order to provide food, the settlers needed the ammunition. Worse yet, to be without it would put them in danger of attack from Native Americans. It is said that Nesselrode received about $1 per pound of black powder. His process for making it was a very slow one because he had to make all his own ingredients, those being saltpeter, charcoal, and sulfur. He then had to grind each one by hand with what was known to the early settlers as a hand mill. The ingredients were then combined, wetted, dried, and reground even slower.
All right. Nesselrode's powder mill comes up a lot. This sign is up at the backwaters. It's got a couple things that aren't that accurate on it, surprisingly. It says the site of Nesselrode's powder mill, which operated from 1795 to 1801. We know Nesselrode's powder mill was on property owned by George Baxter. George Baxter owns all the property here when you're looking at the 1871 map. His name doesn't come up. It comes up here and up here. You know, there's several locations throughout that his name is rather prominent in the land that he owns. And none of it's down here by the river. So close enough, I guess, but slightly misrepresented, I suppose. To the south on Kings Creek stood Hartford's Grist Mill. We're pretty sure that the sign in the park and the grist mill there tells us that Hartford's Grist Mill was in Tomlinson Run, not on Kings Creek. So I don't know how that happened. In 1823, Swearingen's Grist Mill and Heaten Sawmill were built near the same site. Those were on Kings Creek. Nearby is the place where Andrew and Adam Poe, Border Scouts, fought and killed Wyandotte Bigfoot Indian in 1781. That's reasonably accurate. The actual site's approximately a third of a mile away. That's a representation of that battle in the Wellsville Library, I believe, and I'm sorry I can't credit the artists because I don't do that good of homework. This is right next to the sign and clearly says on this spot. Probably when they made this, they thought it would go on the right spot. But it's approximately a third of a mile off. Looking at the 1871 map, it shows it right on the northern edge of the mouth of Tomlinson Run. And obviously there were no backwaters at that time. It would have just been a creek that came out here. This is overlaid with that map, and you can see that, well, the river was a little, obviously not as wide as it is today, so it's probably even underwater under the edge of the river, most likely. But, I don't know why those are in discrepancies. There's another representation of that battle. That's worthy of its entire own lecture. It's probably one of the greatest frontier battle stories anybody's ever shared. It's pretty good. That's Adam Poe's grave marker there in Pennsylvania, a cemetery that, I'm sorry, I don't remember. And we got Andrew Poe's as well, I do believe. And, that's the prehistory of Tomlinson Run. That's what was there before it became a park. And I'd like to argue maybe why they chose that area as a park. The grist mills were certainly the foundation of the agriculture around here. We moved that into clay and bricks and pottery. For time, we moved that into steel. I'm not really sure where we're going next or even where we're at. But hopefully we document it so people ahead, coming forward or after us, will be able to follow a little bit in our footsteps and get a feel for what we did and why we did. I'm going to take one more minute here and quickly introduce another author. Let me dig it out of my notes here real quick. And it's a short two paragraphs. And I only bring it up because I really think it gives a feel for what living at Tomlinson Run might have been like. This household we're looking at here is the Mercer household. It would have been found right at the confluence of the North and South Forks, pretty much across from the boat docks right here on the hill. There were no roads to it. They only had a swinging walking bridge to cross the creek to get there. And the author is Doris Mercer Carpenter, and she wrote this in 1989. The entire thing is called Willow of the Wisp, and she wrote it in the 1920s. But she spends a lot of time talking about what it was like each year at her grandparents' house at that spot. After dinner, when the kitchen work was finished, Grandma and Granddaddy Mercer needed some rest. So my dad, Charles A. Mercer, suggested a walk down the creek to the covered bridge. Off we started over the swinging bridge to the dusty road, up the road over the main bridge spanning Tomlinson Run. That bridge would have been about where the dam is today. The gurgling water voiced its approval for our decision to step in its stones and also walk in its cool flow. The house situated downstream is long gone. Not a faint inkling of a name of its inhabitants can be recalled. That would most likely have been the Murray residents. Below the bridge and downstream perhaps 500 feet, Dad slowed his pace. Stated that he could show us the footprints in the butt of the print of a Native American. He further stated that the clay soil had set and hardened, retaining the prints. He sat there about here, as he said, as he found a familiar spot that jogged his memory, stooped down and began to push the water away, and sure enough, we were surprised to find they were there. The spot is located on the left edge of the run as we leave Grandma's house. I doubt I'm going to find that, but sure is neat to know. On down the stream we went, jumping from stone to stone, almost losing our balance, or just cooling our feet in the cool water, all the time carrying our shoes. Finally, the covered bridge shone in the afternoon moonlight. Wonder what secrets it held. Young love dubbing it a kissing bridge, or a farmer thanking it for its protection in a severe storm, or maybe people like us just remembering more before we start back up the road. That would have been on Washington School Road. So that would have had to have been a covered bridge, according to Miss Mercer. Down the stream beyond the bridge, we came to the site of the woolen mill, which was the old Mill Scout Camp. The foundation was intact, which helped us to understand its workings. Cullen bricks made up the base of the mill. Some are still there. Have your feet gotten wet as you walked with us? Maybe a little tear flowed down your cheek? We must go a few more steps further to the old sheep hole. What could this mean? Well, sheep were herded to a deep spot in Tomlinson Run, where they were dipped in water and rinsed off well before they were taken to the woolen mill for shearing. This spot was adequate with the mill nearby. Everybody knew where the old sheep hole was. I don't. But I just thought that was really interesting insight and completely confirming what we think we know about what's in Tomlinson Run. No doubt, nothing I've shared today is the last word, and I don't claim it to be. But 15 years of running through that place as much as I could, trying to identify every single dot on the map I could put my finger on. And, well, this is what I've come up with so far. So I really appreciate you guys coming out and sharing it with me. And it was really nice to share it with you guys. Thank you. I really appreciate it. Sure, please.
So you didn't elaborate. What was the dynamite for?
You're right, I didn't. It was used in the 30s for blasting the stone for most of the fireplaces and picnic structures and shelters that we have in the park. The dam was in construction into the 40s, and most people think those shacks were there before then. So they very well may have stored it for the dam construction as well. But, yeah, it was, we think, to just build everything else that the park has. And yeah, it's a little bit out of the park, and I didn't mention it, but I wanted to gleam over it real quick. Here's the backwaters, and this is Ferndale Road that comes up. I believe this spot right here is the quarry where Nestle Chapel was quarried from. Their records say that their quarry was 1 mile from the church, and if you measure from the church to that quarry, 9.5, 0.95, I think that's pretty close. But nobody really knows. I suspect that that's the quarry that happened. But we have a lot of quarries in the county, believe it or not. There's more than you would think. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
You mentioned a double waterfall
beyond
the end of the White Oak Trail.
Yes.
And you're skeptical that was actually
park property or not, yeah.
So you don't know if it is park property or not?
I mean, every map I've ever seen shows the park shaped the way it's shaped, that area. That line, however, is the end of Grant District. So maybe someone thinks it's their property line. Maybe they dispute the property line. Maybe it is their property line. I really don't know. If it is the park's property, though, I'd like to see the trail expanded up to that nice double waterfall and let that be a little more accessible to folks, because you get there, you can't cross the creek without getting your feet wet. And you don't have to cross the creek. So the no trespassing signs are the only reason the trail ends. It's the only reason people don't make it up to Elko Rock. It makes it look like it's the end of the park. Every map I have, going back to the beginning of the park, shows that it clearly should be in the park. But I don't want to step on anybody's toes. Teach their own. Anybody else? Yes, please.
I have the joy of spending the week
1949.
Wow.
Starting as a scout, and then 4-H camps, and then of course church camps.
Right.
You spoke about Sheep Rock.
Yes, Sheep Hole.
I remember the trail going down from the bottom barrack.
Okay.
It was CCC barracks.
Right.
Back from the start. They always described going down there. We walked across with a mill. They showed us where the stones were.
Right.
And the Sheep Rock, they said, was where they would bring the sheep and wash, you know, give them a bathe or clean or whatever.
Right.
But the kids, we would spread our towels and things down on this big rock. And then it was deep enough you could swim at the bottom if you wanted. There was a swimming pool there. And they always described that as sheep.
I have never heard it described that way, but I know that hole. So, yeah, interesting. Thank you. I appreciate you sharing that. Anybody else questions or just something you'd like to share? Yes, please.
Are you familiar with SPOOM, the Society for the Preservation of Old Mills?
I am not.
When you said about reconstruction and that.
Yes, I would be thrilled to, like, someday see a mill in Tomlinson Run that, you know, gets fired up from time to time.
Well, people who own mills belong to this society, and I don't think it's much of a fee. They do have a website, and Beaver Creek State Park has the Gaston's Mill.
Yes.
And they do belong. So you.
Okay, so if I can't get what I need, I'll check in with them.
Right.
For resources. Thank you very much. Except I didn't know that at all. All right, well, yes.
Is there a link to that map?
Farm that. There was Tomlinson Run State Park and another piece of property, and then our farm. Our farm is 87 acres.
Okay.
And it had on, there's a sign now on the road that says Wellsville Road.
Yes.
Well, that was on our property.
Okay, I know where that is.
And I remember walking from there clear over down to Route 2.
Oh, yes. Yeah, that's the New Manchester Turnpike links up with Wellsville Road, and you can certainly take it all the way down. Yeah. Question about maps?
Yeah, that map there that you're using, is there a link to that? Or?
There is. It's in my history group. I have a business card here I can give you to help you get to it. They're on Google Maps, and if you search for Tomlinson Run, you should be able to find it. And if not, by all means, you can get it from, like I said, my history group has it. I also have one for all of Hancock County, where I've taken everything significant on the 1871 map that isn't a spring, you know, and found out where it's at on the modern map and put it there. I'm pretty confident on most of its locations. I wouldn't swear by all of it, by no means. But, yeah, it's pretty close. And they're both available on Google Maps. Now, the historic map that I was using, that's the J.W. Beers 1871 map of the northern panhandle, and it has a lot of detail. Like, every one of them blue dots on there is a spring. All the coal mines are there. You can see here it says place where Adam Poe and Bigfoot Indian fought, you know, right above the northern tip of Tomlinson Run. Clay, oil, flagstone, iron ore, it's all on this map, and who owned the property. So I spend a lot of time looking at this. It's available from the Library of Congress for free. You can just download it. And I also have it available if anybody needs it. You know, I can get it to you. But it's a big file. The map's like 3.5 by 6 feet if you were to print it out. So it's pretty big. But yeah, I consider it the best one of the very best resources that I have to dig into pre-1900 history. I use it a lot, and as you can see, I try to mark as many things on as I can on it. That red line you see there represents the New Manchester Turnpike. Every major road that has any significance in today's world, I've tried to do, and I've also done that for the sectional maps. So here's New Cumberland, for example, all the grocery stores. Lawyers, doctors, those things are usually, if I can figure out what it says they are, I'll try to at least highlight them in a way that, you know, they stand out so I recognize them at a later time. But yeah, both maps are available on Google, and like I said, we can throw you a business card here. They're also in my Facebook group. And if you're not a member and you're on social media, please join us. 1,500 of us. Never had one single issue in that group. It's just good people who care about what we got going on locally. So thanks again. Anybody else? Okay, go ahead. I tried to plan one 2 years ago in October, and the weather was miserable that day. There's two great times to do them, in my opinion. One is autumn, because it's just, the park's beautiful. It's just beautiful. The next best time is in March or April, preferably March, when, as you see, when all my video was shot, was when there was no vegetation, which makes it so much easier to find things. And it's particularly easy to find things in the early spring, because a lot of folks planted daffodils and tulips, and they still come up, and they're not wild. So if you see daffodils, in most cases, there was something there. They'll have to be even in a straight line or 90-degree angle, which is a dead giveaway that, you know, humans put them there. I can't tell you how many places in the park in the middle of nowhere you can find daffodils, and there's always something of significance nearby, every time. And, good. Yes, yes.
How far are you on that process, or is that in part of your...
It's a dream. I've not taken one step beyond gathering the information that I think might need to be on that signage. I don't think there's a more comprehensive map of the park. I mean, as far as its history, you know. There's so many things that most folks wouldn't even care about. But they're there, or they were there. There's some sign that, you know, they existed. So I try to document as much of it as I can. For me, it's fun. I feel like I find ruins in the middle of nowhere, and I'm trying to figure out what they are or why they're there. It's just a adventure.
Robert?
Yes?
Erin Checkhart, our newest commissioner,
yes,
was here, and she was very interested in your idea about signage, and her thought was to have those little things that you can scan with a smartphone.
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
They're easy to put up. Yes.
You'll want to be in touch with her.
Okay. Sounds great. Sounds great. Anybody else? Questions or contributions? All right. Well, you folks have been great on a really warm afternoon.
Yeah.
I got to tell you, thank you so, so much.
Robert, I am. Please
take this is the commercial break. This has been brought to you by your museum here in New Cumberland, the Hancock County Museum. It would be so great to see all of you here to help us with these programs and with the preservation of all of the historical items that we have floating around in the county. What are your kids going to do with the stuff when you die? They're going to throw it away. You know, things that were really, really significant in this part of our state. And also, we will be planning other of the series of these talks, and we don't know what the next one's going to be or what the date's going to be, but watch your newspapers, Facebook, and everything, and come out and support the museum. Thank you so much.